Welcome to Programming with Qt Widgets in this fourth, and I promise, final episodes on the tour of the widgets of Qt. We'll look at item widgets, more specifically QComboBox and QListWidget as a representative for the widget view world. I'll also tell you about 7 widgets that I forgot in my tour of all of those widgets, but that's towards the end of this episode. So starting with QComboBox, it's a list of items that you can select. You can select exactly one, and you will only see one, but when you click on the combo box, the list will drop down. You hopefully know about what a QComboBox is already, otherwise you do now, I just told you. Programmically, what you do is that you simply new up an instance of your QComboBox, and then you add your items, add item option 1, option 2, option 3, and so on, and you connect to a signal activated, bringing out which item was currently selected. And well, you can also go to the combo box and ask for what is the current item. That's one crucial thing to add to this here, and that is that if you're using QComboBox, do refrain. Learn from the best. That would be me in this case here. Do not do string comparison when you want to see if it was the item for delete the hard disk. Do not go and check whether the item currently selected is the string delete the hard disk, because eventually it'll be translated into another language or you will find a spelling error and forget to update that. So you cannot rely on the text. And the index is also somewhat troublesome, because the index, what happens if you add something to the top of that combo box? Well, the solution is to use the data part here. So create an enum, for example, that represent each of those items, and then go and ask for the item data or the current item data. There's current index and there's current item data, which will tell you that item data. The data itself is wrapped in a Q variant. We'll talk a bit about that later in this training session here, but very close Q variant, very short Q variant, is like a union in plain C. It can hold either this or that, and then you can unpack it when you need so. You'll be able to figure out how QVariant works if you look at the documentation. If you're using Qt Designer and you're using combo boxes, I think I already gave you that trick, but for you, it's a couple of months ago. Well, for me too, also, when that was recorded, namely that you should not populate your combo boxes from within Qt Designer, because that has the problem of index and string, namely that you do not, inside of Qt Designer, have the option of adding the data part when you populate it. And after all, how would you add the data part? Would you? You do not have access inside Qt Designer to your enums, for example. I have an episode in Qt Widgets and More where I show you exactly how to populate a combo box from Qt Designer, but populated on the C++ side. There's a link right here, right now. Another thing that is worthwhile to say about the QComboBox is that it is a rather powerful widget where you can do lots of different things. And let me just give you another hint or another link to Qt Widgets and More, where I used a combo box for selecting employees in KDAB. And some of the employees have weird names, like my middle name is Kia, which funnily enough means cute if you translate it. And the third letter there is the Danish letter A. I'll bet you that unless you come from Denmark, you do not have that on your keyboard. But the rest of the world have agreed that if they see an A, they will type A-E in replacement of that. So I created a combo box that could complete on that. And similar, Germans have the O with a umlaut, that's two dots above the O, and my combo box can complete that just with a capital or with a letter O. So go and look at that episode here. So that was the first of the two widgets to talk about in this episode, namely QComboBox. The other is a representative for three widgets even, QListWidget, QTableWidget, and QTreeWidget. And if you have just a wee little bit of knowledge about Qt already, you will know that there's also QListView, QTableView, and QTreeView. And these three of them goes together with the model view framework. The QListWidget, as we'll see in just a second, you give it the data, all the data up front. The list view, table view, and tree view, there you have a separation of the data and the view, and the view just calls upon something called a model, where it'll go and fetch the data from the model. There's a whole module on model view programming Qt coming up in a month or two, so stay tuned for that. But even when you watch that, you might come to the conclusion that this tree view with the Q abstract item model behind it is actually super hard, and it is until you created your 5th, 6th, 10th tree model. I've created a few hundred of these by now, admittedly most of them being the same one in these trainings, but I have created a lot of tree models, so I understand what goes on there. But I admit that if you ever just want one tree, then it might be easier to go with a Q tree widget. But just be aware of the other. So as you see here in the slide now, the QListWidget looks like this. You create an instance of QListWidget, and then you can add an item to it, add item, item one here, or you can create a list widget and give it the list as a parent. And the difference there is super important, because the add item, there is no data associated here. And let me just go and look at the documentation for you here. Add item takes a label and nothing else. Nothing is returned from it. So the data is in that label given. That's okay. Choose the country you live in. And here's a list of the countries of the world. Denmark, just where I happen to be living, is the string Denmark. And it doesn't cover for anything else. But if you wanted to have some data structure around Denmark, then it's getting difficult, because then Denmark as D-E-N-M-A-R-K, that, I don't know, Sweden will invade us one day, and then we'll be Sweden too. And then Denmark and Sweden too, those two strings that doesn't compare. So if you have some additional data, then you go with the QListWidget item here. You can either add the QListWidget item, or as we saw here, you can simply create your QListWidget item and give it the list widget here as the parent, and it will be in that parent. There's also, besides the add, and there's add items. So for the situation of the countries of the world, you likely have them in the string list already. Add items and you're done with it. And then there is the insert versions down here. There we are. Insert item at a given row, either a string or the list widget item again. If you have data, then what you do is that on that list widget item, you can call set data with Qt colon colon user role. Why user role? Well, that will be apparent when we talk about model view programming. And then your data, and again, your data here is an instance of a Q variant. QTable widget and Qtree widget, same kind of mechanism. And what you need to understand is that you give it all your data up front, which is cool with countries of the world. There is give and take 200 of those, but it's not cool with all the cities in a country. I mean, how many cities are there in, say, India? Lots, I would assume. So that was the two widgets, two plus widgets, that is organizing lists. And as I promised you, I have a list of 7 widget. Huh? Jesper speaking? Uh-huh. Well, I know that your widgets do not look exactly like the widgets that I've been showing here in this training, but, well, hang on there. They work exactly the same. They just look different. And that's because that they are stylable on the different platforms. You can even create your own styles. Well, it would be too much to tell you over the phone how you do that, but there is a link in the training that I'm actually recording right now that tells you how to style, and there's a mini episode by my good coworker David Four on that. Yeah, okay. Talk to you later. Sorry about that. As I said, there is 7 widgets that I did not mention here. Let's go to Qt Designer and see them. The first widget I forgot was from the container section. And I looked through the container section and said, yeah, I did not go into much detail about the MDI area, but, and here's my excuse, it's not sitting down here, it's sitting up here, and this is the one. So if I select these two, I can put this one between them and put the whole thing into a layout. And now when I preview this, what you'll notice is that I can change the size between these two. It's called a QSplitter, and the QSplitter is either horizontal or vertical using the enum Qt colon colon horizontal or Qt colon colon vertical. And if you are using this by programmatically, then what you'll do is that you'll simply create an instance of QSplitter and then add child, I believe it's called, or add widget and add these widgets. And inside of there, you can then get them, get the layout and see, you can even collapse sections here and there and so on. And one of the cool things, and let me just go to the QSplitter, if I can spell it, splitter. One of the cool thing about QSplitter is that you can actually save the layout. So in save state here and restore state, and you can stream that using a Q settings, for example. So you can do the same thing with Q top or with top level. So you can restore and save the state of a Q widget, which means that the geometry or Q dialog, at least, I'm not sure about Q widget, but then you can save the layout of your user interface. That was that phone ringing before that got me all. The user interface, you can save the layout using these facilities. Time for me to have a break. OpenGL, DirectX, Vulkan. Oh, there are so many things to consider these days if you want to do 3D. Take a 3D training from KDAB and get a clear mind. Next, there was a few widgets from the input widget section that I forgot. So let's just go through the whole section. We talked about combo box just now. Then there's a QFont combo box, and I just preview it here. And see, this is a specialized combo box that's already pre-filled with the fonts of my system. So there you go. If you're creating a text editor that supports different fonts, line edit, text edit, got that, spin box, double spin box. Well, I guess you can figure out that's a spin box where you can specify doubles. Then we got time edit. That looks like this. We got date edit. We got date time edit. So let's just preview them. Here I can specify a certain time of the day. I'm scrolling the wheel when I'm going up and down. This one is I love that one, the usability of this one. Do you want to go out for beer this Friday? Sure, let me just look in my calendar. That's not how you look in your calendar. That's just not very useful for that purpose. I'm glad that the Qt company finally got around and added a feature to this one and to that one down here, by the way, too. Namely, if you scroll down here in site, calendar pop-up. Have it for both of them here. Why is that not the default? It ought to be the default. This is how you select a date, not by scrolling with a arrow up and arrow down, similar select the date down here. Why is that not the default? I guess it's because it was an afterthought that came way after this widget was created. So by all means, create a commit hook that will check whether it works. There's a link here to a Qt widgets and more where I told you about my commit hooks, and I guess I'll be creating a commit hook to validate if I have a Qt date edit that it actually has this one set. Anyway, what else did I miss? That was this one to go away. What else did I miss in my list here? I forgot about the vertical and horizontal scroll bars. And well, you can figure out what a scroll bar is, but you can create them yourself if you really want to. You would usually not do that. What you usually would do is to have a Q scroll area as we talked about in the previous episode. And finally, this one, I gotta admit, I learned about that this today. The key sequence edit. And let's just see what it does. So press a shortcut. Okay, Control S, Control A. There is your shortcut for that. That's a super useful together with the Q key input. Q key sequence is called to Q shortcut. So from now on, the users in my application is going to be able to customize shortcuts all over the place. This is a widget for specifying the shortcut. And yeah, that's going to be awesome. That was it for the input widgets. That was 7 already. You're not keeping score, are you? Oh, well, I 10 then. Come on. So in the display section, that was a few too. So Q Graphics View, we already talked about that, or hinted at that in the previous episode. There's going to be a whole module on Q Graphics View itself. It's a gigantic framework. Q Calendar widget, well, that's this fellow here. You have it as a widget on its own. Do not necessarily need to be pointed up from these two here. Then we have QLCD number, my favorite widget of them all. If you don't understand why you would have something that looks as weird as this, that's because you are not from the 80s and have had an alarm clock back then. This is the 8-segment display, 7-segment display. That's what our alarm clocks look like back then. So if for some reason you want your application to look slightly ancient, then there you go. The lines we talked about, the OpenGL widget, well, that is if you want to have some OpenGL content rendered in your application. This is definitely not the place to go and learn about that stuff, because my knowledge about OpenGL boils down to that it's something to do with triangles. For that, however, there's lots of good content on KDAB TV. So Google KDAB and OpenGL, and you'll find lots and lots of stuff on that. And finally, QQuick widget. My start of my fame came from being the YouTube darling of our QML training, and this is what this is about. You would not use QQuick widget if your application was purely a QML, then you'd use QQuick View. But if you just want one tiny part of your application to be rendered using QML, possibly in a migration effort, then you can use QQuick widget. So there we are. Here's my QQuick widget. And inside there, I'll have QML. Don't ask me why my screen flickered. I don't know. That completes this mini tour through the most common widgets in Qt, and diving a bit into details and hidden gems and whatnot. In the next episode, I'll talk about layout management, and it's going to be really interesting. So stay tuned. And until then, have a great time.